An exciting event we were all looking forward to. Some of you have, I want to put your mind to ease. It's a combination of all these things, all right? Now, actually we are gathered here to honor a man who put his heart and soul and money too into writing a book. The book, Capitalism, A Panacea for Socio-Economic Woes. And that man is John Matthew Thekill, and we call him affectionately Sonny. Writing a book especially of this nature and caliber, is no easy task. I know he spent countless hours studying, researching, and writing, and editing, and rewriting. And he spent a lot of money also to get it printed and published. Now, I know he didn't write this book to make money, but he wrote this book to benefit others, especially the people of underdeveloped nations, in particular a nation called India. I know John Matthew grew up in a socialistic democratic country and later was transplanted to a social or capitalistic society. But he didn't learn the advantages of capitalism after coming over to the United States. He was convinced, even before he arrived, that in the United States, the system that's adapted in the United States is far superior for economic progress. As you say, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. When he came, of course, he enjoyed the fruits of capitalism here, the luxuries and amenities and opportunity the capitalism offered. He was all the more convinced that capitalism is the system to follow, especially in India. And if India had followed this, the fruits of the system could have been enjoyed by all the people of India. Once again, I want to welcome all of you. And it thrills me to see so many distinguished guests here tonight. Some of you traveled long ways from Dallas, from Austin, from Tyler, and some from Sugarland also. Not too far, right? Now, we are greatly privileged to have all these distinguished guests. And I would welcome each one of you. And you will hear from some of them, especially Verghese Kampalatha, George Strake Jr., Dr. M.S.T. Nambudri, Dr. E.C.G. Sudarshan. Is Peter Matthews here? Okay. Now I want to welcome each one of you to any event that we all were looking forward to. Now, to get things started, first we'll have, if you look in the program, we'll see that we start with some comments on this book. The first one to come up here and say a few words is Verghese Kampalatha. Verghese is a teacher at the Houston Independent School District. He has a master's degree in economics from the University of Delhi. And he's a teacher, he's a thinker, he's a philosopher, and he's a writer. And as you know, he wrote the preface for John Matthew's book. And Verghese Kampalatha will speak to us now.
Mr. Strake, gentlemen and ladies, and particularly the center of our attention today, Mr. John Matthew Thacker. I want to start with a little correction. I didn't take my master's degree was not in economics, it was in social anthropology. We had a communication problem. John Matthew Thacker called me about 3 weeks ago and told me that I had to say a few words about his book. And he gave me 3 to 4 minutes to accomplish this Herculean task. I did not even feel even mildly offended or miffed by this limit put on my time. In fact, I was relieved because all I know about economics can be said exactly 4 minutes. I only want to make a few simple observations. I know while speaking about a specialized subject, I can get no respect, or I can get respect only if I'm decently confusing. But for the moment, I'll forgo that option. My only connection with economics is that I spent 2 years in Delhi School of Economics in the early 70s. I did not study economics at DSC. I studied social anthropology and suffered with my professors and fellow students acute self-doubt because we still were disputing if social anthropology could be called a science or it had any future in a country trying to pull out of the doldrums of chronic underdevelopment. But across the hall we heard echoes of Fabian socialism discussed by high-profile professors of economics trained in DSC's illustrious forerunner, the London School of Economics, founded by Sidney and Beatrice Webb, the two leading lights of English Fabianism. I'm glad that Fabianism has fallen into disrepute in most of India today, and I feel good about not studying economics in those days, because if I did, I wouldn't be able to read John Matthews' book as objectively as I can now as a social anthropologist. But before I get into the book itself, let me say a few words about the book's author. John Matthew and I have known each other for about 3 years now. First, we needed a three-way telephone to communicate with each other because we were only friends of a common friend. Then the draft of this book 2 years ago brought us into close contact. I had no time then to read or discuss the book. John asked me only to write an opinion of the book, but instead I wrote a profile. The profile now has ended up as a preface. After that, we talked to each other many times, and he has left me with a distinct impression that he is one of those individuals who could easily become the center of controversy. Two well-known dicta have contributed to this impression. They are, knowledge is power, and ideas change the world. John has knowledge and ideas, or in other words, he has power to change the world, and he is willing to use this power. Such people get into a lot of trouble. They become the center of controversy because there are people out there who don't like change. They are blissful in their ignorance, comfortable with the status quo, and willing to fight to preserve it. But there is hope for John. His ideas are winning, particularly in India. About 250 million Indians, the so-called middle class, are eager for a share of the good life, and the rest of the world seems to be enjoying. They will welcome these ideas as we do now and admire him for his courage of conviction. Another reason for us Keralites to admire John's effort in publishing this book is that he is one of the very first Malayalis among us writing in English. There are many Indian writers, some of them very well known, who have published novels and non-fiction books in the English language, but they are known as Mukherjees, Chowdhuries, Singhs and Seths, Mathers and Malgongars. Matthews, Menons and Muhammads are very rare among Indians writing in English. I came across the work of Shashi Tharoor recently, the great Indian novel and the business, and the show business. Tharoor is a very prominent and promising novelist, but basically he is not a Malayali. He is a Malayali only in name. He was born in London of Malayali parents, was educated in Boston, married a Kashmiri, and lives in Delhi, Calcutta, and Bombay, and works for the United Nations. So we have very few, in any case, contemporary real Malayalis writing in English. John Matthew is trying to do his best to remedy the situation, and at the same time, he is giving us a very practical lesson that if we want to advance our ideas, and if we want to have our ideas wider appeal, we better start writing in a language which has a larger following than our own regional language. Now this brings me to the word itself. Capitalism, the panacea for socio-economic development or wars. Anyone who has lived in India and in the United States can never dispute the benefits of capitalism. So the thesis of the book needs no proving. It has been proved by lived and living experience. So we can all congratulate John Matthew for his foresight, his ideas and his service, as Mr. Strait pointed out, not only to India and the United States, but to the whole world. From the very title of the book, we know India is the focus of the book. But India is a complex country, and to solve its problems, we need more than a slew of general statements. We need more than the conviction generated by well-thought-out arguments. We need to examine the economic theories of the past and the policies and the behaviors of our leaders. We need to understand the Gandhian approach to development, staunchly endorsed in a well-known book, Small is Beautiful, by a well-known British economist, E.F. Schumacher. We need to examine the principles of Bayesian socialism and its consequences in the nationalization of institutions and the planned, centralized, protectionist economy that, instead of encouraging competition and creativity, has promoted mob-up dependency on the government. Capitalism comes in different shades and colors. Francis Fukuyama speaks about liberal capitalism. E.F. Schumacher speaks about capitalism with a human face. And Michael Novak speaks about capitalism based on morals and ethical ideas. We have to examine also the very important role played by religion in the development of the spirit of capitalism. In Europe, Calvinism, in Japan, Jodo Shinshu. We have to examine if our religion or religions have the same compelling moral authority to inspire frugality, honesty, integrity, hard work, and the moral mindset necessary to legitimize profit-making. John Matthew speaks about freedom and equality. They are written into the Indian Constitution, but freedom and equality in our Constitution are not functioning laws. They are merely statement of intentions. Freedom and equality are things that we bestow upon each other. We are free when we do not take away other people's rights. We are equal when we treat each other as equals. In communist system, the state bestowed equality on individuals, and we know what happened. They were all equal, but as George Orwell said, some were more equal than the others. So this book, for all its merits, is still in its seminal stage. It has potential to grow. I'm sure John Matthew has not said his last word on the subject of capitalism. We expect his ideas to grow and help the country we Indians love and care for. John Kenneth Galbraith said, India is a rich country with a lot of poor people. George Bernard Shaw said in a very different context that rich men without conscience are more dangerous to a country than poor women without chastity. We have wealth in the country, but it is hoarded and mismanaged by venal men and women who have no conscience or even common decency. That is one of the main problems in India. And the question before us is how to build up an equitable, fair and just society where we respect one another for nothing else, but we are all human beings and treat each other as equals. So that is a question before us, and that I hope is what John Matthew is going to take up in the revised edition of the book next time. I promise to limit myself to 4 minutes. I notice that each one of my minutes has run into more than 60 seconds. You know, in our culture, sometimes we make promises not to keep them, but to make you feel good. So I ask your pardon, and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Varghese. Next we have Dr. MST Nambudri. Dr. Nambudri has a PhD in mathematics and a master's in computer science. He's the division chairman of nature science, natural science, mathematics, and computer science in Texas College in Tyler. He also teaches computer science at the University of Texas in Tyler. He came to Boston in 1963 and was a professor in India for 6 years and at Wisconsin University for another 6 years. Recently, some articles appeared in Dallas News about him. I didn't get a chance to read all of it, but he is a journalist, he's a writer, he's a mathematician. Dr. Nambudri.
Thank you very much for that lovely introduction. I don't know whether I deserve all those nice, kind words. Mr. Strait, Dr. Sundarsan, and other distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. When he called me a couple of weeks ago to say a few words about his book, I told him first to send me back his book. And then I read for a couple of days, and I called him back. Okay, I said I'll say a few words. And then he asked me to write a book review on the topic. Well, they said I need more time for that. But anyway, I'm going to try my level best. As he said in the introduction, I'm not an economist, nor am I an expert on socialism or capitalism. But as a student in India, high school and college, I used to be very politically active, mostly associated with left-wing organizations like Students Federations, Workers Union, Agricultural Unions, Labor Unions. Like many others in those days, I was fascinated by catchy slogans like, "You have nothing to lose but your change, but a whole world to gain." And also, to each according to his ability, and to each according to his needs. I'm sorry, from each according to his ability, to each according to his needs. Those days we marched through the streets shouting these slogans, which meant very little even to us, except to create a sense of passion and a momentary excitement. I still remember the year 1951 when I was in college for my second year. We organized a strike in my college. I was one of the ringleaders. We wanted to conduct a struggle against the bus fare we call season tickets for students. The students took their turns in laying themselves on the road, blocking the traffic. 5 students at a time lay across the road. And the bus traffic completely stopped for the whole day. At the end of the day, the principal of the college, the president of the college, called me to his office and warned me against disrupting the traffic. He didn't do anything against me then, but next year he denied admission for me to that college. Well, I didn't stop my education then, but I could now, when I look back, I understand why he did it. The reason I'm mentioning this in connection with this book is because you see how political parties, in cooperation with these unions, students' unions, labor unions, farm workers' unions, etc., can disrupt important vital activities of industries, business, and education. Even now, When I, whenever I go home, I see this political hysteria all over that place. People cannot take. They are hysterical about politics. Newspapers highlight politicians. Even people who go to tea shop to drink tea talk about politics every day morning. They don't talk about creating capital, creating jobs, helping people, but they talk about politicians. Now with this brief introduction, let me get into his book. I read his book completely. From chapter to chapter, even though I have some disagreement with his title, it is too late for him to change it, I know, but I started from the title. I just wanted to call him and say, look, is it too late for him to change that title? I'm not trying to say that, but for me, I think no system is flawless. No system could be a panacea for all the socio-economic woes. To me, I think the reason for these woes should be found at a higher level. Let's call it spiritual level or philosophic level or what have you. When you look around, for example, even in a capitalistic system like this, you will see still we have socio-economic woes. You see sexual promiscuity rampant. You see violence. You see increasing crimes. You see lack of neighborly relations. And you see also greed. Now, I'm not talking about the profit, but you see greed also. So to avoid all these, I think an economic system alone cannot solve all these problems. But I'm pretty sure in revising his book, but when he wrote this book, he meant also, I believe, along with the capitalist system, we got to have spiritual values, family values, sustaining, more sustaining, and the transitory accumulation of material things. Material things alone won't bring happiness to be. We can see that here in the United States, right here. And going back to the book, in chapter, first of all, let me say this. John Matthew's book is a great contribution to the understanding of why capitalism succeeds where socialist systems fail. In six chapters, the author takes the reader along for an intellectual tour, comparing and contrasting the two systems of thought, both on economic and philosophic levels. He produces convincing arguments that the capitalist system is a prerequisite for freedom and progress, and socialism leads to decline of both. In special reference to third world countries, especially India, he brings out the relationship between the growth in the economic, in the public sector, to the increasing role of government and the benefits of market economies over command economies. India's series of five-year plans were centrally designed and government controlled, and as such were doomed to fail, according to the author. He also acknowledges later that the present liberalization program initiated by Prime Minister Narasimha Rao augured well for the future of India. And given the technological and intellectual potential of that country, it is likely to be an economic power to be reckoned with in the 21st century. After chronicling the collapse of communism in the former Soviet Union and Gorbachev's hesitant slow approach to economic reforms, the author correctly identifies the reasons behind the failure of reforms under Boris Yeltsin. Russian people who were not accustomed to ways of free market and capitalist system were shocked by the shock therapy tried by Boris Yeltsin. For 70 years, they worked in factories and collective farms under the strict orders and guidance from their committee bosses and local communist leaders. The output of factories and farms were determined by the body with no incentive or reward for individual performance. Even the milk they produced in their private homes had to be carried to the local party headquarters for a minimum price determined by the state. The only infrastructure, if one can call it, was the party structure. local, state, and central committees and Politburo. And 95% of the Russian people had no power in decision-making, like setting quotas of production, price-fixing, and personnel. The author makes the correct conclusion that the main reason behind the collapse of communism is its lack of understanding of the inner character of man, his natural instinct for freedom, freedom to produce, freedom to enjoy profits and rewards, and freedom to speak. His appreciation for a capitalist system reaches a climax in chapter 5, where the author plays a glorious tribute to the Reagan revolution of the 1980s and attributes his success to the generous tax cuts which put more money into consumers' hands to stimulate the economy. On page 77, he argues that poverty and other problems are mainly due to social and moral changes and relate the poverty in the United States to increasing number of single-parent families. Questions could be raised whether capitalism could be a cure for such social and moral problems as sexual promiscuity, premarital sex, welfare, and teenage violence. On my way here, I read that article in the Houston Post. Since he mentions Adam Smith in his book, this was another reference to Adam Smith in Houston Post. Whatever he said in his book is also documented in that article today in Houston Post. What he said about Adam Smith, because he wrote Wealth of Nations, he also wrote Moral Sentiments. What he said in that article was, since we are in the process of reforming our welfare system, what he was trying to say in that article was, before we reform the welfare system, we have to address the cultural issues produced by economic dependence. Now, he talks about economic dependence in this book. Too much government involvement creates economic dependence and creates an underclass, economic underclass. He talks about that in his book. And that creates social issues like violence, crimes, sex. So the point is, unless we solve these problems first, don't try to reform the welfare system. That's what his point. Cultural issues have to be addressed first. Okay. Along with material prosperity, should we also stress spiritual values, family values, mutual respect and compassion? These questions are not addressed directly in this book, which deals primarily with economic prosperity under capitalism. The contention that any economic system is flawless and a panacea for all socio-economic woes may be debated for years to come. And satisfactory solutions to all human problems may be found at the spiritual level, where more permanent and sustaining values are stressed and practiced. Despite this, the author convincingly establishes an indisputable truth that no other system ever designed by man so far in history has provided a solution to these woes than the capitalist system. And herein lies the contribution of this book. It is readable and is well written in simple English, understandable to ordinary consumers, and is fully illustrated with charts to document this theory. Brief biographical sketches of important economists add to its attraction. I highly recommend this book, not only to my Indian friends, but also to all many. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhutri, for those thought-provoking remarks and observations. Next, we have Dr. E.C.G. Sudarshan. He's a professor of physics at the University of Texas in Austin. Professor Sudarshan received his PhD from the University of Rochester in 1958 and was a Corporation Fellow at Harvard University from 1957 to 1959. Professor Sudarshan received several honors and awards.